Thanks everybody for coming out. And you too, David. So good to be here with you all. Thanks for everybody. I know some people drove from near and far. So I'm gonna take you back to a time and a place. The early 70s, late 60s. I grew up in a place called song just kind of encapsulates, that's the biggest word you'll hear from me this evening, that time.
You ready, bud?
I do believe.
Because I'm not.
Played hockey in the street with all the other kids.
I had hand-me-downs. I remember my first hockey stick. It was Mr. Goudreau that lived on King Edward and used to work at the Fraser Mills. Took two pieces of a broken hockey stick and screwed them together, and that was my first hockey stick. But, so you know, but my Uncle Roland, oh God, I can't look at you, huh? My Uncle Roland was the uncle that used to help us out. He would take us, geez.
Yeah.
He would take us to the PME, he bought us bicycles, you know, we used to stay over at his place all the time. And I mean, it wasn't, let's face it, it wasn't the best environment in the world. They played cribbage and drank, and I think my uncle was a bootlegger. And you know, we're little kids, and so we heard every word that starts with F and all that sort of stuff, you know. But anyway, Rolly lost his way. Rolly lost his way later in life. And he lived on the streets of New Westminster. And in 1984, we found him one day, and he's always, in the picture, he's got a crew cut. He always had a crew cut, but by now he couldn't afford a haircut anymore. So we found him on the street one day, we brought him home, gave him a bath, we bought him a suit at the Salvation Army, and it was $10. Somebody, some sweet soul, slipped $10 into the pocket of the suit that we bought at Salvation Army in New West at 8th and Columbia there. And not too long ago, you know, we tried to take care of him because he took care of us, and he was found dead. In a parking lot. And in those, and you know, he had contusions, and it was in a stairwell. And we don't know to this day if he was pushed down the stairs or somebody. We just don't know the answer because he was a street guy, and this was 1984. People didn't. They didn't care like they do today, you know. So anyway, and this is my tribute. This is my tribute to Rolly Coon. And I do have a clock here, so I won't be going all night. I think we're gonna try to hit somewhere around an hour. Unless someone bribes me.
How much?
$5.
Five? Don't sell yourself to
me. Any guitar players out there? I'm playing this. So I get this capo. It's called a half capo. It's just half a capo, but it makes sounds like this. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
So this capo helped me write this song, but what other thing helped me? I was at a songwriting camp. Here I go talking some more. I was at a songwriting camp in the Nahatlitch Valley. It just burned down this year, consumed by fire. But that's where I kind of got a real kickstart with my songwriting. And there was a lady there who had written a song about a hobo or something. I thought, hey, wait a minute, I can write about Mount Rolly. And yeah, so Rolly Coon. Somebody asked me, what are you saying in the chorus? And my family are crib players. You know, I've met people on the street that say, hey, your uncle's a great crib player. Anyway, the chorus is 15-2, 15-4. Best crib player in 64.
I told them. You all
going great, yeah, you bet.
It's a guy that I knew that, and then I went
went to meetings with him, and I've been sober ever since that day. So, a little bit more of the story, got into the 12 steps and all that sort of stuff, and some of you might be familiar with what they call step 5, that's where we go, with a Catholic, that's like confession sort of thing, but a little deeper, you go and write out a detail of all your characters and defect and all that sort of stuff. So I went, I had made an appointment with this fellow to tell him my tale of woe and all my dirty deeds that I'd done in my life and all that sort of thing. And he was a 22nd in Cambie. He was a teetotaling Anglican minister. And you know, I mean, there's no nice way to say it. I mean, I'm kind of a foul-mouthed scumbag from Alertville. I don't know any nice way to say that. I think I remember picking up my auntie one time and my backseat of my car was full of beer bottles. I don't know if she remembers that. Yeah, I was giving you a ride somewhere in Kamloops. We're in Kamloops or something. I don't remember. It's been a long time ago. Anyway, now I'm distracted. Okay, yeah, so I went to see the retired Anglican teetotaling minister at 22nd Cambie. And I told him my tale and my story, you know, my defects of character, my moral inventory, that sort of thing. And, you know, he kind of nodded and looked kind of shocked where he was supposed to look shocked, I guess, and all that sort of stuff. But you know what? The guy blew my mind. And he did it with a word of encouragement. Encourage one another and build each other up. So I wasn't used to words of encouragement where I'm from. We all sat around the table like that. We'd be full of ashtrays, cigarette butts, beer bottles, and yakking. You know, BS? Just yakking and yakking. And this guy told me something that I immediately knew was true because I know what BS sounds like. And when I heard the truth, it was like instantly recognizable. And he just told me a couple of things about my character. And I knew he wasn't BSing because I was a reader. Because that was, we didn't have video games and all that stuff when I was a kid. So I would escape by reading, you know. And so I had picked up a little bit of a vocabulary from that. And he just complimented me on some things. So he gave me a word of encouragement. And, you know, I left that place there that day. I drove there an angry young man in my 67 Dodge Dart with a slant 6 with a smashed up door. With a fend, with a radiator from a Ford, because I could wire it in with a coat hanger. Anyway, I drove there an angry young man, but I drove home peaceful. And I used to know all the shortcuts, right? So I wiggled away on my home from 22nd and Cambie where I lived at BC Honey. If anybody remembers that, 6th Street and 13th Avenue, I lived there. And on the way there, I had to pass by a park. I was at 14th Avenue, I forget the name of the park, just before Canada Way, there's a little park there. And you know, when I was a kid, they sent us to Sunday school because they all had hangovers and, you know, wouldn't you send your 6 or 8 kids to Sunday school if they sent the bus? I would. Anyway, they sent the bus, and so we learned the songs and the kids' songs in church, right? And I was driving by that park, and I can't. Anyway, I sang, Jesus loves this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Well, right then and there, this may seem a little strange to some of you, right then and there, I started bawling like a baby, because I'm like, wow, what if that's true? And then I felt like oil being poured over me, like just all over me. And I went home that night, cried like a baby, and it was February. It's cold, crisp February night where the stars are just blazing, right? And I went on my porch, and words came out of my mouth that I'd never have to drink again. Yeah, so that's my story of redemption, I guess you could say. And you know, since then, lots of stuff's gone down. I won't talk about it. But I wrote this song. I was singing it at our church, and I'll teach you the chorus. chorus. It's just, it's called More of You, Less of Me, More of You. So if you want to sing along, the chorus is just More of You, Less of Me.
Good.
Yes, sir.
good, just like he said his word. By his grace, I've been saved. When trouble's come on every turn, another chance, a lesson to learn. Stand for you, your boy, your truth. If you stumble,
not have to move like I did, because we would have troubles and we would move. So my kids went to the same school their whole life. And that really gave them a lot of stability. So my daughter, yes, Stephanie's 27, so I kind of wrote this song for her. And it kind of just describes house we used to live in. It's called When Sam Was Six and You Were Four. And every time I play it, if I had $1 million, that's what it sounds like to me every time I play it. I'd buy you an ottoman, not a real green dress,
but no Chesterfield, brother.
No Chesterfield.
It's like Dijon mustard ketchup. There's felt pen markers on the wall to show how tall you were when Sam was six and you were four. Take orders. 2022, I celebrated 36 years of sobriety. On December the 8th, I was diagnosed with stage 4 prostate cancer. The oncologist said, you've got 2 to 3 years to live. You're too far gone for radiation, you're too far gone for chemo. And get your affairs in order. So, do you know what the first thing I thought? I was going to make a joke, but I don't. If I might have another. You know, well, the first thing in my mind was, and it wasn't me that this came from, the first thing in my mind was, it ain't going down like that, man. It just ain't going down like that. You know, I've got a God in my life, and it ain't going down like that. That's the first thing I thought. So, I spent thousands of dollars on alternative therapies and all that sort of thing. Anyway, one of my bucket list things to do in my life was to drive across Canada. So I bought an old van, I bought a cot, put it in the back, I got a fridge, I had stuff to cook with, and a kettle, and all this stuff, and I took off across the country, thanks to my wife for let me do that. I left on May the 25th. And I didn't really have any lofty, noble ideas about what I was, you know, going to raise funds for cancer or anything like that. It was just like a compulsion to go do it. So I had some wonderful experiences and met relatives that I'd never met in Saskatoon and all this. It was really cool. Anyway, got to Thunder Bay, Ontario, and there's a memorial there for Terry Fox. And I was not thinking about Terry Fox at all. This never really crossed my mind, you know, because that's 42 years ago. Anyway, Terry Fox Memorial, oh, cool. I can go check it out and use the bathroom. So, you know, and so I get up there, and then it hit me. Wait a minute, this guy's going across Canada. He had metastatic cancer, I have metastatic cancer. His middle name is Stanley, my middle name is Stanley. And there's a bunch of other, I'm Métis, I have a little bit of Métis, he's Métis. And Terry was a Christian, for those of you that don't know. And so I bawled my eyes out like I would, you know, there, because wow, really? And then I left Thunder Bay and I went to Sault Ste. Marie, the Sioux. It's a tough town. And it was very smoky. It was at the time there was fires in Ontario. So it was really smoky. So my friend, Bruce Olson, phoned me. He said, Dave, he was in Ontario. He said, Dave, don't come. Just stay there and wait for the smoke to go. So I did. So I sat in that motel, the Northlander Motel, room number 14 in Sault Ste. Marie. I got the same room when I went back through Canada. Anyway, I wrote this song about Terry and me, and it's called Run Canada. Run Canada, run, run, run. Oh yeah, by the way, this is my friend Matt Koyanagi. Give it up. Two of my heroes.
We actually worked this out in advance, don't believe me.
No.
Verse and chorus that I had to my co-writers. I didn't really know it was about me, but it was about me. Like halfway through the song, I was like, hey, this song is about me. Anyway, this is kind of how I, some of my feelings about my diagnosis. Oh, that's my soul.
That's my soul. That's
going on and they're playing guitars. They went there and do the thing. And it was fun. So I joined them with my guitar. And they kept saying to me, "What's your story?" And I'm like, you don't want to know my story. You guys are having a party, you're having fun. Go ahead. You know. And then they kept asking. So I told them the story I just told you. Played the song that I just played to you.
Mike's not on.
What's that?
Mike's not on.
My mic's not on?
It died.
It did?
It's coming through there.
It's still
like...
coming through.
Okay.
Is anybody else having trouble hearing?
No.
Dave, well, you're deaf because you're a rock and roll. Come sit at the front.
I want to one, two.
Hey, how about that?
Okay, there we go. Sorry about that. Anyway, well, now you're blowing your ears out, Dave.
That's the
fifth. Anyway, I was at the Newfie party. That's where we were. We're at the Newfie party, right? I mean, that's the best place to be anyway. We're at the Newfie party, and they asked me my story. I told them my story, and then they said, "Well, sing us one of your songs." So I sang that song that I just played. Five complete strangers came up and gave me a hug afterwards, after that song. And that happened a couple times in different places. So anyway, that song's just been finished recording, and we've got a little EP coming out. Anyway, this is a Terry Fox song. This is life and death. We both been through the rain, running to save our breath. It's a generation later, and I am on your trail, driving through Ontario still, searching for a cure. You started in Newfoundland, I started in BC. Thunder Bay was your D-Day.
A boot. Is it the boot or
no? The thanks card.
The what?
The thanks bucket.
The thanks bucket. There's a thanks bucket there too, where you can donate to the Terry Parker Foundation. I'm not a fundraiser, rah-rah type guy, but I really looked into the Terry Fox Foundation and I like how they do things. So if you could donate a few bucks to the Terry Fox Foundation, that would be awesome. Also, my website, I ran so far behind me, but I have my website. I put some cards, that's my website, you can go there later as well. We're also doing another fundraiser for Matt's dad, who's a fellow named Roger Coinani, awesome guy, taught all the kids in Surrey how to skate. And they looked after kids, right? Like premature or drug addicted. His dad was they looked after drug addicted kids and stuff like that. Really cool guy, passed away just around COVID, never really had a memorial or anything like that. So Matt and I are doing an album together. Well, it's not a whole album, it's four songs. But we're doing an EP together, and we're calling it Roger That. And we're having a memorial for Roger on September 9th.
Yep.
And we're getting CDs made for that. I've got CDs too. I forgot to bring them in, but I'll go grab them. So that's my fundraising blurb for the evening. So, as a songwriter, I try to be original and all that sort of thing, you know. But sometimes you just gotta write what God gives you. You gotta work with what God gives you. And David. And this song came to me called The River. And I'm like, I don't want to write a song called The River. Joni Mitchell's got a river song. Bruce Springsteen's got a river song. Garth Brooks has got a river song.
Monty Alexander's got a river song.
Okay, good.
Imagine if you called it Reed.
So, anyway, I just did as I was told and wrote a song called The River. And I'll teach it to you, gosh darn it. It goes, same when we get to the chorus.
Thank you.
there's grace to spare. Let's all go to heaven. Let's all go in mercy. Let's all go to heaven. Let's go where there's grace to spare. Let's all go to
I'm gonna hold my body down. If he walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If he walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If he walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. Thank you.
Make me a poster.